I wanted to see who'd be faithful tonight. We're not really doing Leviticus. We're going to start Revelation. Just kidding. Aaron's like, oh. You know, J. Vernon McGee, one of my, you know, people always said about J. Vernon McGee and Pastor Chuck, the unique thing about them is if you ever just happened to randomly turn them on the radio, they were one of the only people that you could know exactly what they were teaching on because they were always teaching through the Word. And, you know, J. Vernon McGee, I said that Leviticus was the most important book in the Bible. Fascinating. You know, Leviticus is an extremely important book, even though it can be laborious at times. And I will be honest, as we go through things, we will probably move fairly quickly. I'm not going to try to describe every single creature they weren't allowed to eat. You know, we will go through some of those portions more quickly than maybe some other passages in the Word. But at the same time, we're not going to rush through the book because there's wonderful truths here that are for us. You know, Leviticus continues the story of Exodus because while Leviticus picks up right where Exodus left off, it almost seems like it's just a straight continuation. And even though that seems to be the case, there is a clear subject difference, though, between Exodus and Leviticus. It's not just Exodus part two. Exodus was all about God's promises to a new nation, and God has kept those promises so far. One of those promises, as we studied through Exodus, was that he'd be their God and they'd be his people. That's been accomplished. God has entered into a covenant with Israel, and even despite their sin of idolatry, he has forgiven them and descended into their camp to dwell in the tabernacle. So that has been fulfilled. But Leviticus, now that that's been fulfilled, tells its own story, a story of holiness. See, the question from this point is, now what? You know, what is this new relationship with God going to be like? How will they spend time with him? With any relationship, you spend time. Will it be like the pagans do with their gods and their temples, or will it be different? And God's answer in the book of Leviticus is clear. I am holy, so you must be holy as well. Leviticus chapter 11, verse 45, the Lord's words ring out those exact concepts. He says, "For I am the Lord that brings you up out of the land of Egypt to be your God. You shall therefore be holy, for I am holy." That exact phrase will be repeated four times in the book of Leviticus. In fact, the word holy is mentioned 611 times in the Bible, but 94 of those times is in the book of Leviticus, more than any other book. In fact, Leviticus is quoted and alluded to in the New Testament more than any other book in the Old Testament aside from Deuteronomy. So that's important. You know, if Jesus referenced it and other New Testament writers referenced it, we should probably try to understand it. So what does holy mean? Well, when we use it in regards to God, it means distinct, unique, separate, free from evil. It refers to God's purity, his majesty, and his glory as distinct from his creation. It speaks of his worthiness to be worshiped by his creation. And as such, he should have a unique part in our lives as Lord and first love. Now, it's in light of this attribute that we're called to be holy. Since God is unique, we can't be like him in those ways. We don't have a majesty, or we're not to be worshiped. We don't have that innately about us. But, you know, for us, it means that we're to be pure from evil. We're to be set apart to God's way of doing things. See, a believer's new relationship with God is to be pure from evil. The standard for worship and for living isn't the same as those who don't follow the Lord. We're to be different, unique, to live our lives in such a way that it draws attention to how our God is better than idols, how his love, his goodness, and his ways are superior. This is why the book of Hebrews often corresponds to Leviticus. In fact, you probably can't understand Hebrews very well unless you know Leviticus. The theme of Hebrews is Jesus is better. That's the theme of Hebrews. The goal of Leviticus is that our lives will show that God and his ways are better. So to accomplish that, our lives have to be unique. They have to be different. They have to be set apart. They have to stand out. And so when we look at the purpose of the book of Leviticus, for Israel, it was very clear. It was their call to be holy. The word Leviticus is the name given to the book by those who wrote the Septuagint. The Septuagint was a Greek translation of the Old Testament written by a lot of probably liberal Jewish scholars at the time. We're not the only people who have liberal, you know, people who are students of the scripture. And you know, they were embarrassed by things like, you know, God has wings, you know, hide me under the shadow of your wings. They're embarrassed by that because the Greeks mocked that kind of stuff. So they changed a lot of things. Well, they gave this name Leviticus because Leviticus means pertaining to the Levites. Unfortunately, that's not an accurate description. In fact, there isn't really much about the Levites in Leviticus. The book applies to all of Israel. And when it focuses on religious duties, it speaks more to the priests, not the Levites. They are a distinct group. The priests came from the Levites, but they're a distinct group with Aaron's family only. The Levites were their assistants. So the original Hebrew title was Vayikra, which means, and he called. And this is more appropriate because the book shows Israel's calling as God's people to live and worship in a holy manner. So it was their call to be holy. It was also there to clarify their moral and ceremonial laws. When we talk about the law of Moses, Leviticus is the third book of the law. You have Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. They're all part of the law of Moses. The third book, this one, it clarifies certain parts of their laws. Now, so have you ever had somebody ask you, like, how do you know which laws to keep in the Old Testament? Anybody ever had that? Just me. Okay. All right, we've lost you all already. No, maybe, I'm sure you probably have. You know, maybe you've even seen people be critical and say, well, you know, they stone people for working on the Sabbath these days. So, you know, apparently then these other things that are, you know, whether you're talking about sexual sin or something like that, that doesn't apply anymore because we don't stone people on the Sabbath. It's important for us to understand which laws apply and which don't. The law of Moses can be divided into three parts. You have the moral law of God, which never changes. That is always right is right and wrong is wrong, okay? Then you have the ceremonial law, which deals with their worship, their cleanliness. And then you have the civil laws. That dealt with their interaction with one another in society, okay? Remember, Israel is a theocracy. God is in charge of their nation. They're not like us. They don't have a government like we do. So they had different laws to govern their civil behavior than we do. So when we talk about what laws apply to us, the ceremonial laws don't apply because we don't have a temple. We don't have these ceremonial cleansings. Jesus fulfills all that. So they don't apply to us. The civil laws don't apply to us because the church is not Israel. We are not a nation, you know, under God in that sense of a theocracy of the church, you know. We aren't reigning in that sense, you know. We will reign with him when he comes back, but that's in his millennial capacity as the king of the one who's, you know, promise the sorry, my words are not working tonight. He is the one who is fulfilling the promise of the Messiah, the reigning Messiah to Israel. So we're not reigning with him in the sense of the church is reigning, but we're reigning with him in the sense that we're his bride. So and that's part of what our task will be. So the civil and ceremonial laws do not apply to us. God's moral law never changes. It's always wrong to steal. It's always wrong to lie. You know, these are the things that we will see as we go through this because those laws don't change. Now, because the primary goal of Leviticus is to clarify their moral and ceremonial laws, we're not going to see a whole lot of the civil conduct laws here in the book of Leviticus. Most of the commands and the prohibitions have to do with either God's moral law or Israel's ceremonial law. And like I said, God's moral laws apply to every generation because right and wrong never change. It's still wrong to seek supernatural empowerment by drinking the blood of an animal or a person. It's still wrong to commit sexual sin. It's still wrong to consult a witch. Those are not okay things, you know? On the other hand, though, the ceremonial laws where we have to bathe a certain way or you have to bring a certain sacrifice to the, you know, to the tabernacle, they do not apply to us because we're Christians. We have a different way of relating to God. Look at Hebrews chapter 7 with me. You might want to keep your finger in Hebrews. We'll be touching back and forth a few times. You know, you might see things, you know, going the rounds at times, you know, on social media where atheists or other groups are critical of Christians and say, oh, you're hypocrites. You take part of the Bible, but you don't take all of it. And it's because they're ignorant. I don't mean that in a mean way. They're just ignorant of how the Bible works. They don't understand that the Bible actually tells us it doesn't apply to us anymore. They were for Israel because they were governing their civil and ceremonial behavior. But Hebrews 7:12 explains that does not apply to us anymore. It says this in verse 12 of Hebrews chapter 7. For the priesthood being changed, now that Jesus is our high priest, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. I mean, that's what it says. We do not operate by the same laws. There's much more that the scripture has to say in Colossians chapter, I don't have it written down, so I'm going to guess it's chapter 1. Nope, 2. Chapter 2, verse 16, let no man therefore judge you about food or in drink or in respect to a holy day or of the new moon or the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is Christ. So these are things that they, as we'll see later on today, point forward to Christ, but we don't practice them anymore because the Bible tells us not to. It's not because we just cherry pick things and say, well, we like that, but we don't like this, and this doesn't, it's not very palatable, but this still is. We don't make those choices. The Bible explains to us what's okay and what's not okay, what we have to keep and what we don't have to keep. So we'll be pointing that out as we go through the book of Leviticus. Now, you might be asking, well, why bother studying Leviticus then if much of it doesn't apply to us? If it was just for Israel, aren't we wasting our time studying things like offerings and feasts and dietary laws? Well, I'm going to give you two reasons why it's important we go through the book of Leviticus, even in regards to things that don't apply to us in our behavior anymore. Number one, like we saw in the tabernacle studies in Exodus, Jesus is a fulfillment of all the ceremonial laws. Like I just read in Colossians, they were the shadow, he's the real deal, you know? And so we understand the real deal a bit better by looking at the shadow and seeing how God had prepared his people for when their Messiah would come. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1, it talks about how Jesus is the fulfillment of all of these things. It says in Hebrews 10, verse 1, for the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image or substance of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. Those Old Testament sacrifices, all those things could never make us totally right with God. They were almost like a Band-Aid in a sense. You know, Jesus is the substance. These were the shadow that pointed forward to him. So we're going to see awesome pictures of Jesus in all these things that we don't do anymore. And then secondly, not only does everything point to Jesus, but everything paints a picture of how we're to be holy in our lives too. You know, in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2, Paul makes one of his many references to Leviticus when he says this. He says, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and has given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. He references these offerings, the sweet smell that they would, the aroma that it would bring up of the barbecuing meat, and the idea that it would be pleasing and acceptable to God. And in the same way that our lives should be the same type of a thing to him, you know? The scriptures in the New Testament are full of references to the sacrificial system in Leviticus, teaching us how we ought to live our lives. See, just as each of these ceremonial laws points to Christ, many of them paint pictures of how we're to live as Christians. So the command may not apply, but there's a principle behind it that does. And we need to learn those principles to be a mature believer. Because 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17 says what? For all scripture is given by inspiration of God, right? And it is all profitable for our maturity, for our benefit, you know? And 2 Timothy 2, 3, 17 says that the man of God might be perfect or mature, thoroughly furnished, fully equipped unto all good works. You know, everything we need to be mature, we're going to find, you know, in all the scriptures. And therefore, we need to study and we need to understand and be able to apply Leviticus to our life. Now, as we start here in Leviticus, we begin our study with how Israel was to be different in their worship of God by looking at the offerings that they could bring. See, part of Israel's holiness had to account for the fact that they weren't holy by nature. So just as the priests required special garments to approach God, Israel would need to perform special offerings to approach God. Now, because these offerings could only be performed by the priests, they, the priests, would have to be consecrated for the task. And because God's absolute holiness couldn't allow any presence or reflection of sin to be in his presence, Israel would be required to live in a certain way to keep themselves pure. And that's the study of the structure of our study of Leviticus. The offerings are found in chapters 1 through 7. Then the consecration of the priests in chapters 8 through 10. Then the rules for ceremonial cleanness in chapters 11 through 15. And then the laws for moral cleanness in chapters 16 through 22. Then we get some of the rules for the holidays in chapters 23 through 25. And the last two chapters kind of sum it all up, you know? So that's what we're about to embark in. And I hope you are on the edge of your seat. So let's dive in. Leviticus 1. And the Lord called unto Moses, and he spoke unto him out of the tabernacle of the congregation, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, if any man of you bring an offering unto the Lord, you shall bring your offering of your cattle, even of the herd and of the flock. Now, before we get into this offering here that we'll get into, the burnt offering, there were five major offerings that Israel could bring. There were other ones, like the drink offering, the heave offering, the wave offering. There were other offerings they would bring. But these were the five major offerings. Three were voluntary, two were compulsory, required, okay? The voluntary offerings were the burnt offering. Then you had the grain offering. If you have a King James, it says meat offering. I think if you have a New King James, it might say meal offering. It's just a grain offering, so a non-blood sacrifice. Then thirdly, you had the other voluntary offering was the peace offering. And we'll talk about each of those in their turn. The compulsory or required offerings were the trespass offering and the sin offering. We start off with the voluntary offerings, and the first one is the burnt offering. But before Moses gets into that, he just gives from the Lord a general instruction for all offerings. For it says, the Lord called unto Moses and spake unto him, notice this time, not from Mount Sinai, but from where? Out of the tabernacle. He's in the tabernacle now. His presence is there. That's where he's going to meet with Moses. That's where he's going to meet with his people. So he speaks to him outside, from out of the tabernacle of the congregation, and he says this, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, here's the rules if they're going to bring an offering, basically. So, you know, again, this marks Leviticus as the continuation of Exodus. It picks up where Exodus left off. God's glory fell on the tabernacle. Now he's there, and now he's speaking to Moses from that place. Now it says here, if any man of you should bring an offering, it's undefined. So this is a general rule for any kind of offering of an animal. He says, if you're going to bring an offering unto the Lord, you're going to bring that offering of the cattle or of the herd or of the flock. So it can't just be any animal. You can't walk in with your cat. You know, if you have a really annoying bird, I don't know anybody who has one of those. If you were to have a really annoying bird, you can't bring him, you know. The animals had to be normally cultivated for food in society. Those were the animals that you would bring, okay? Now, before we even get into this, I know that people often have difficulty with the idea of animal sacrifice. I get it. You know, and it's usually because they associate it with some, you know, Hollywood movie with a crazy priest plunging a dagger into an innocent creature and then throwing the carcass away to rot so he can move on to the next animal bloodshed, you know, to occur. The pagans did do those things at times, but even many of their sacrifices were associated with feasting or, you know, drunkenness or, you know, sex and whatnot. And less with the Hollywood films of a crazed priest who's just bloodthirsty. God's institutions and instructions for sacrifice are not like that at all. In fact, the meat would be used to feed the Levites, the priests, and their families. For certain offerings, it would be used for feasting, you know. For the peace offering in particular, you're encouraged to invite all your family, all your friends, and it'd be like a big, big, huge barbecue at the tabernacle where you just worship God and hang out with him, and, you know, they would just have a big, huge party. So, you know, some of it was used for that. In every case, the animals were handled in the same way a local butcher would. They would not suffer very long, and they would, you know, the meat would be then used as best as it was possible. You know, nothing would be wasted or tossed aside as meaningless. Even the meat that would just barbecue on the altar, there was significance for why it was barbecuing there. It had meaning. Everything had meaning. So with the burnt offering here in verse 3, he begins, if his offering be a burnt sacrifice of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish. He shall offer it of his own voluntary will at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. So here we are introduced to the burnt offering. The word there, burnt, means that which is wholly burned up. So this offering was one that would be entirely consumed on the altar. There would be no feasting accompanied with this. There would be no sharing of food, none of that. All the meat would barbecue on the altar because the idea was all of it was being consumed by God. Now, the burnt offering is not new to Israel. Abraham offered burnt offerings. Moses' father-in-law offered burnt offerings. The burnt offering symbolized or communicated one's absolute surrender to God. You'd be losing all the meat of the animal, so it always came at great cost. It was not just, you know, and he realized, you know, this is not something you would just do and go, hey, you know, honey, grab one of the cows out there. Let's go sacrifice to the Lord. I mean, that was something you either purchased or something you had cultivated, something you had used. I mean, this was, you know, either a beast of burden, something that was of worth to you. And it cost you a lot to bring it as a burnt offering because you wouldn't get any benefit from it. So the idea is that as all of the meat was burning on the altar, one's entire life was being given to God. That was the symbolism behind it. Now, This is why it was a voluntary offering. You know, God didn't require them. He said, you're going to bring me everything you got and you're going to bring it to me now and it's going to cost you, you know. The Lord, this was up to them. It was their choice, you know. They had to come and say, you know, I want to give the Lord my whole life. I want to surrender my life to him. Sometimes what a Jew would do is they would say, you know, Lord, I've kind of been slacking lately. I want this year to be different. I want to offer a burnt offering to you. I want to be sold out to you this year and just live for you completely. And they would come, and they probably wouldn't say it like that. I'm a little more modern. But, you know, they would come and they'd bring a burnt offering to the Lord. And it would be symbolic of the fact that they were not going to, you know, compromise, or they were not going to mess around with God's word anymore or God's law. They were going to do it the right way, and they'd give their whole lives to him. And so that's what's being referenced here. Now, God would give them three options for their burnt offering depending upon their income level. The wealthy are instructed first. For it says, if his offering be a burnt offering, bless you, if his offering be a burnt sacrifice of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish. Now, the herd here would be a large mammal, in this case, a bull or an ox. This is not something everyone had. In fact, the modern day equivalent would be somebody bringing a tractor or something like that, is what I heard someone say, and that's probably most appropriate. This was an incredible expense being brought forth. And so for them, they could bring this, and for those who are more wealthy, if they wanted to say, Lord, I give you everything, they couldn't bring a turtle dove like the poor people. They had to bring the big tamale, you know? They had to bring Bessie, or they had to bring the ox, you know? They had to bring something that cost them, you know? And so if they were going to do that, they would bring a burnt sacrifice of the herd. They, it gives the requirements. He would have to be a male without blemish, okay? It doesn't mean that the females were blemished. It just means there's a reason for it. There's symbolism there. We'll get to that later. Let him offer a male without blemish, so it could have no defect, no handicap. Literally, the phrase without blemish means of prime market value. This had to be your best stuff. I read a story once about a farmer who... you know, he wanted to give something to the Lord, and he said, honey, he said, you know, when the calves, you know, give birth, you know, the cows give birth, he says, you know, we're going to give one of them to the Lord. And so, you know, the cow had two, and one of them didn't make it, though. And so the guy came in and said, honey, the Lord's calf died. You know, because it was not as costly to him to give that one, you know. And the idea was, no, you need to give your best. You know, it needs to be of prime market value. And that was part of the priest's job. He was to inspect the animal to ensure that you were bringing your best, you know. And so, but it mentions here, though, it's of your choice. He shall offer it of his own voluntary will, his own choice, at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. So it was not required. It was something you chose to do. And I love that about, you know, the Lord. He's such a gentleman, you know. He's such a gentleman. He doesn't demand you're going to do this. He doesn't, you know, yell at you and scream at you and say, give me your life, you know, because if you don't, you're a bad follower, you know. But he loves us, and he draws us to himself. So we get to the place, say, Lord, why wouldn't I give you my whole life, you know? You know, what is it? There's a story in the Old Testament of the servant, you know, who it has to be set free every 7 years, but maybe he comes to the end of the 7 years and he thinks, man, I'm not very good at it on my own. I always get into debt, you know, and I'm always having to go back into servanthood. And I like my master. And you know what? I'm better off serving him. And he's a good master. He takes care of me. And so he would consecrate his life and say, I'm going to be his servant for life, a bond slave. You know, that's how we are. When we come with our lives to the Lord, we say, Lord, you're just so good. I'm not good on my own, but you're good when I'm good when you're in charge. I want to serve you with all my life for the rest of my life. And that's what this was about. It was a voluntary offering of your life to the Lord. Now, there was the job the offerer had, and then the job that the priest had. The worshiper, it says here in verse 4, when he would bring it, he would put his hand upon the head of the burnt offering, and it shall be accepted for him to make atonement for him. So he would take his hand and put it on the head of the animal. And in fact, the place there where it says he shall put his hand upon the head of the burnt offering, it connotates the idea of to kind of lean on it. The idea is you're not just touching it and keeping your distance. You're going to hear that thing breathing. You're going to hear that thing that there's life pumping through it. And then you're going to feel as its life goes out. The idea is there's seriousness here. The action symbolized that the bull was taking the worshiper's place. For it says here, and it shall be accepted for him to make an atonement for him. The phrase make atonement means to provide a covering. You know, there needed to be a covering because none of them were worthy of offering themselves to God. You know, it's funny because if you share with someone who's not a believer, you know, but they kind of have an affinity for God, or they like the idea of God, you know, and sometimes they'll tell you and say, well, I'm turning over a new leaf. You know, I'm gonna start living for God. I'm gonna start doing things right. I'm gonna start, you know, being a better dad, being a better husband, and being a harder worker. And you say, well, that's great, but there's one problem. Why should God accept that from you? I mean, on what basis can you just kind of waltz up to God and say, hey, God, you know? I mean, the equivalent would be, you know, of ISIS just walking up to the people, you know, who are trying to kill him and being like, hey, guys, you know, we're going to have a change of heart. We're going to turn around and we're just, you know, could you just kind of leave us be and let us alone? No, you're going to jail. You know, we're going to take you in, you know, because we can't let you harm anyone else anymore. The same idea as us with God. We're an enemy walking into the camp. And if we don't come under the right terms, which is an absolute, you know, recognition of guilt and then a coming under Christ, we can't be accepted. So here they couldn't just come and say, God, I want to give you my whole life. Now Isaiah says that all of our good deeds are like filthy rags in God's sight, like menstruous rags is what that means. That's not a pretty picture. So how can I offer to him anything of worth? There had to be a covering. So the animal served both as a symbol and a covering for sin. Now, placing one's hand upon that animal, you know, it drove home the reality that our sin separates us from God. This would be a time of reflection and prayer. They would not just put their hand on the animal and then the deed would be done. No, that the person there would be given time to ponder the significance of what he was doing, to confess any sin, to pray with and commune with the Lord. And so, you know, as he would be there in that reflection and time of prayer, he would say, Lord, I'm not worthy to give you anything, you know, but I love you and I want you to have my entire life. Please accept this substitute for my sin and accept the offering of my life. And when that was done, the priest would then do his part, verse 5. And he shall kill the bullock before the Lord, and the priest, Aaron's son, shall bring the blood and sprinkle the blood around about upon the altar, that is by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And he shall flay the burnt offering and cut it into his pieces. And the sons of Aaron the priest shall put fire upon the altar and lay the wood in order upon the altar, on the fire. And the priest Aaron's sons shall lay the parts, the head and the fat, in order upon the wood that is on the fire, which is upon the altar. But his inwards and his legs shall he wash in water. And the priest shall burn all of it on the altar to be a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord. Now, the idea here is, it says, and he shall kill the bullock. That's not the offerer. I know it sounds like it might be because the he in verse 4 is the offerer. But the problem is nowhere in Israel's history did the offerer perform this deed. In fact, we get a clue when we go down to the turtle dove where it mentions that the priest will handle that. He's the one who will wring off its head and burn it on the altar. So the death act was completed by the priest, not by the offerer. And I think that's important because when we look at the reflection of how this points to Christ, you know, Jesus said, no man took my life from me, I lay it down. And he's also not just our offering, but our high priest. So the priest then would slit the animal's throat, the blood would drain, he would die pretty quickly. And then, you know, the animal would, you know, die. And at that point, then they would be underneath, the sons would be underneath with a golden bowl, and they would catch the blood that was there. And then they would take it and they would spatter it on the altar that is by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. So the altar of sacrifice, that's where the grate would be on the top of the altar where the meat would barbecue. And then the priest would begin the work, and this would take a while, I imagine. He will flay the burnt offering and cut it into his pieces. The word there, to flay, it means to strip or to remove the skin. Most commentators believe that this would then go to the priest for clothing. So they would hold on to that and use it for that. But then they would cut it into pieces. They would butcher the meat into various sections, like any butcher would do. And then it mentions that the sons of Aaron, the priests, they'll put fire on the altar and lay the wood in order upon the fire, verse 8. And then they would, it's kind of a monstrosity here, they'd lay the parts. The head would go first, then the fat, and then in order upon the wood, and then all the inwards and the legs, they would wash it out first with water, but then it would all go on the altar and it would burn. I mean, you would see this, you know, the other sacrifices were oftentimes bound to it like this, and then there'd be different parts that would be butchered and cut. The burnt offering was entirely different. It was a monstrosity. And I think the idea there was again, to be a reminder of just how ugly sin is, you know? That sin is a monstrosity that keeps us from God. It is but by God's grace that he accepts us and receives not just us as his own, but our lives in consecration to him. Now, It mentions here that after they do all this, it says the offering will be completely consumed on the altar, verse 9, as a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord, a sweet smell, a pleasing aroma unto the Lord. You know, when we barbecue it at my house, you know, it's a big deal for our family. I'm not much of a cook, so when we do it, it's kind of a big deal. And, you know, it's always exciting. The kids get excited and stuff. Oftentimes, we barbecue at friend's house or family's house. It's usually for a special occasion. But either way, it's a time usually we, in our culture, for those closest to you to enjoy each other's company. In the Middle East, eating together with someone was a major affair reserved only for the closest of friends. And so the idea is that as that meat burned on the altar, it was evidence that God accepted the offer of surrender. You know, if something happened to the meat and it wouldn't burn or something, you know, that'd kind of be symbolic of saying that your life isn't pleasing to me, I'm not accepting it. But the idea that it would be consumed on the altar would be that it was pleasing to God, that the offering of one's life was accepted by him. All was well between you and God, and he was pleased by the fact that you wanted to surrender your whole life to him. Now, verse 10, we get to the offering for the middle class Jew. It says here, and if his offering be of the flocks, namely of the sheep or the goats, for a burnt sacrifice, same deal. He shall bring a male without blemish. Now, different here, he mentions he will kill it on the side of the altar. Again, the offerer couldn't even go in that far to the tabernacle, so that's how we know it's the priest that does the killing. He shall kill it on the side of the altar, which is northward before the Lord's presence there in the tabernacle. And the priest Aaron Shun shall spatter his blood round about upon the altar, and he shall cut it into pieces with his head and his fat, and the priest shall lay upon them in order, or lay them in order on the wood that is on the fire, which is upon the altar. But he shall wash the inwards and the legs with water. The inwards were the intestines, all that kind of yucky stuff that had to be cleansed. And the priest shall bring it all and burn it upon the altar. It is a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord. So the offering in the middle class would be of a sheep or a goat. And this is the one that most people would bring. This would be the offering that would be most common for the priests to see. And the only difference between this and the ox or the larger mammal, the bull, is it seems to be the location of the death blow, because it wasn't outside by the door. It was actually inside the tabernacle on the north side of the altar. And then also the animal wasn't skinned. No reason is given for these differences. I'll share a little bit at the end why I think it might be, though. And then verse 14, we find the offering for the poor. It says, and if the burnt sacrifice for his offering of the Lord be of fowls, then he shall bring his offering of turtle doves or of young pigeons. And the priest shall bring it unto the altar and wring off his head and burn it on the altar. And the blood thereof shall be wrung out at the side of the altar. And he shall pluck away his crop, that would be the gullet, you know, with its dung, it would be the digestive tract of the bird, had to get rid of all that stuff, that would make it unclean, and with his feathers, you know, so that's just all the gullet that's in there, and you'll cast it beside the altar on the east part by the place of the ashes, the place where the trash would be put, and he shall cleave it with the wings thereof. He'll spread the bird out on the altar. I don't know how he did that, we get no description, but he shall not divide it into two, he won't cut the bird up. And the priest shall burn it upon the altar, upon the wood that is upon the altar. It is a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, of a sweet savor unto the Lord. Now you might be saying, well, how do you know that these are for different income levels? It doesn't say here. You're right. But it's explained to us in Leviticus chapter 12, which we'll get to later, where it explains, depending upon their standing in society financially, they can bring these different offerings. Now, Leviticus 12 explains that a burnt offering was to be brought not just in surrender, but it was to be brought to dedicate every child and to make the mother ceremonially pure again. So you would bring a burnt offering in that situation as well. In light of that, I'd like us to look at Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. There's always some funny teaching out there about Jesus's economic status in society. The Bible doesn't leave that out for doubt, though. It tells us exactly what Jesus' economic status was in society. For in Luke chapter 2, verse 21, it says, and when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child, Luke 2:21, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the days of her, that's Mary's, purification, according to the law of Moses, were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. This is proof that Jesus grew up in a poor family. You know, he grew up in a poor family. Jesus did not grow up in wealth. He, you know, I've heard people talk about how Jesus had his Rolls Royce and some other crazy stuff, you know. Don't buy any of that junk. The Bible gives us clear understanding of what Jesus's economic condition was. He was poor. He was probably far worse off than you and most of you and I are. Now, in light of that, there's good to that, because it means he knows what it's like to have a need. He understands what it's like when you don't have the money to pay a bill. He is truly a great high priest who can be touched with our struggles. Amen? Well, that brings us to the end of chapter 1, and I'm not going to go any further, although I probably will cover two offerings at a time from this moment forward. So read chapters 2 and 3 for next week. But we're not done yet, because we've talked about how everything points to Jesus. So how does this all point to Jesus? Turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. We'll be in the New Testament from this point forward. 1 Peter chapter 1. First Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and 19. 1 Peter 1, verses 18 and 19, referring to our redemption, our salvation. It says, "For as much then," verse 18 of chapter 1 in 1 Peter, "for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers," our old life. We were rescued from our old life, but not with silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb, what? Without blemish and without spot. Jesus was our lamb. He was our burnt offering, without blemish and without spot. Look at John chapter 10. John chapter 10. The burnt offering was a free will offering. Look at what Jesus says here in John 10, verses 17 and verses 18. John 10, verses 17 and verses 18. Jesus says, "Therefore does my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No man takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received from my Father." Jesus was our free will offering. He offered himself by his own choice. He was our burnt offering. Look at Hebrews 7 with me. Hebrews 7. See, I told you Leviticus was the most exciting book in the Bible. Hebrews 7. Hebrews 7, verses 26 and 27. "For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners and made higher than the heavens, who needs not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice." The daily sacrifice they offered up was the burnt offering. Every morning, every evening, they offered the burnt offering. He doesn't need to do that. "For," it says, "to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself." See, Jesus was the administering priest. Just like he was the one who would take the animal and cut the animal's throat and then do the work of presenting the offering, Jesus presented himself to the Father as our burnt offering, a lamb slain for us. One other thought to share. I believe Jesus was the lamb that was offered on the north side of the altar. It's interesting, the lamb was the one that was offered on the north side of the altar. John the Baptist didn't say, "Behold, the ox of God who takes away the sins of the world." He didn't say, "Behold, the turtle dove of God that takes away the lamb of the sins of the world." He said, "Behold, the lamb of God." And what's interesting about the lamb is it was the one animal that was sacrificed on the north side of the altar. The hill of Calvary is on the north side of the temple. You know, kind of fascinating. Do you know Jesus' whole life, it was a burnt offering to the Lord. In John chapter 4, verse 34, Jesus says this. He says, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. John 6, 38, Jesus said, for I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. Jesus' life was one that was fully surrendered, fully yielded, fully consecrated to God. He is the fulfillment of the burnt offering. Cool stuff. You may say, okay, Will, how does this point to us? Well, you've probably already caught on, if I haven't been too obvious. Look at Hebrews chapter 9 with me. Hebrews chapter 9. We go to our scripture reading now, and the last few verses there, verses 13 and 14. Hebrews 9, 13 and 14. It says, for the blood of bulls and of goats, and the ashes of a heifer, all the various things that the Israelites did to sanctify, purify their flesh. If they could bring these offerings, if he could come to the door of the tabernacle with an ox or with a lamb or with a turtle dove, and if they could come and do that, any person could do that. And God would receive it and he would accept their surrender. He would see them as cleansed or purified so he could accept their full surrender. Paul says, a writer of Hebrews says this. He says, if that's true for them in the Old Testament sacrifices, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? See, it points to us in the same way that our lives are to be voluntarily surrendered to God. We're to offer up our lives as a burnt offering to God on a regular basis. You know, Pastor Chuck said this. He said, one of the problems today is the incomplete consecration of so many lives. He said, we hold back so many areas from God. God wants you to present yourself totally, completely to him, not reserving, not holding anything back for yourself, but a total consecration. That's what he wants. And he's so worthy of it because he is so good. He can take better care of us than we ever could take care of ourselves. And so Paul echoes that statement. You know, he says the same thing in chapter 12 of Romans, verses 1 and 2, when he says, therefore I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, because of all the mercy God's shown to you, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. See, we don't go and put our bodies on the altar so that, you know, he could plunge the knife and cut up the meat and all that kind of stuff. We bring our lives as a living sacrifice. We willingly lay down on the altar and we say, okay, God, I trust you that whatever you need to cut away, whatever work you need to do, I'm wide open and I completely trust you. I'm fully surrendered. I'm not holding anything back. Paul says, you do that. Because that is holy and acceptable unto God. It's your reasonable service. And don't be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. That our lives might be like a sweet aroma unto the Lord, even as Jesus's was. So the burnt offering, Jesus is our burnt offering, a life fully yielded to God. And for us, that we're to yield our lives fully to God as well. Amen? Let's all stand. Oh, Lord, we thank you so much for this beautiful picture that we have in the Old Testament sacrifice of what you did for us, how you held nothing back from your Father. You said, I do always those things that please the Father. The words that I speak, they aren't mine. They're what my Father wants me to say. And then, Lord, at the very end, you said, Father, glorify your Son with the glory I had with you before I came into the world. Lord, you fulfilled your mission. You were a man who was fully yielded to God. And Lord, we want to follow that example. In the same way that your life was a sweet-smelling savor to the Father, Lord, we want to walk in love and have our lives be a sweet-smelling savor to you as well. And so we present, Lord, ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. Lord, we don't deserve to be able to do that, but we give ourselves to you fully and completely. Will you take us as your own, Lord? Will you fill us with your Spirit so we can live it out each and every day? Lord, that's our heart. In Jesus' name, amen.